Thanks so much for joining us and giving us your time again.
Thank you very much.
Cooperative governance, what does that mean exactly?
What it means is that as the Constitution prescribes, that in South Africa we have one government. Mm-hmm. One government with three spheres. Cooperative governance means that these three spheres have to work together in a coordinated fashion to address issues of governance. Does not only end there, it then says in a democracy it takes an informed civil society to have democracy thriving. So through cooperative governance we mobilize ourselves within government but also mobilize stakeholders outside government so that we then together work to build this South Africa the good that we want to see. This South Africa better served in the manner we want to see. So that is exactly what we do.
So I'm just trying to get a clear picture for our viewers. Do you float around then the various departments, ministries, particularly around governance to support, I guess, the work that they are doing? Do you even crack the whip maybe sometimes if they're not performing?
Well, each department has line function activities assigned to it at national and provincial level. And of course, the three spheres have got the competent authorities assigned to them. They operate according to that. But what we are interested is to coordinate. We're not operating in a silo arrangement. We are operating, you see, there is no activity that any government department does that is not done at the local area.
Right.
How then do we coordinate our activities? So that it's more about a coordinated approach and not a competition. That's why we then say for municipalities, even when they develop their plans for development, the IDP of a municipality will then contain what that municipality is going to do, but also what other government departments are going to do in that local area. So there is a need to coordinate that. Well, you spoke about cracking the whip.
I
think in a coordinated approach through sector engagement, reminding each other to then say this is what we need to do. It will come out very clear next year, 2013, because we are going to have coordinated governance sessions, forum. The first one, us giving a report in terms of the state of municipalities in the five areas that I spoke about in a particular province and what other departments are doing to provide support to these municipalities and also our traditional institutions.
Is this not just another layer of government perhaps we don't need? Because I'm just thinking, if all the ministers get together in cabinet and discuss what they're doing, surely it's the job of the president to coordinate. And you don't need another layer of government to be coordinating these structures.
You know, there is what you call coordination on the field. We have departments in terms of the outcomes-based approach, where we have signed delivery agreements to then say on the field, as we deal with the delivery of the programs we committed to, we will work together.
Right.
Now, you don't imagine that at that particular level, you will say there is no need to do that because there is cabinet. You don't have to say that there is no need to do that because if you are grouped together in a delivery program, you look at doing that. But when it comes to cooperative governance in traditional affairs, we then see by grouping in terms of the nature of the work, we may not be grouped with other departments. But like I've indicated, all these departments perform at the local area. There's a need for those on the field to coordinate. So that's the kind of coordination that we're talking about. It's not like so institutionalized that you'll then say that then takes away the role of cabinet. No. It's to then say on the field. Because, I mean, the department that deals with water supply is a distinct department dealing with that, but they supply water at the local area. The department that deals with housing does that. Mm-hmm. Now, this development need to talk to each other.
So that in the rural areas, because often, you know, communicating with the people in the rural areas is not always the best. Do they know that they can engage with you? And if they can, what issues can they bring to you if they feel perhaps that their local municipality or their local governing structures are not helping them?
That's one area that by design, they are supposed to know, mm-hmm. because we do have ward establishment, ward committees, and we do have ward councillors, but that is an area that we keep on strengthening. Mm-hmm. We keep on strengthening. That's why I think it would be proper to take advantage of this show to introduce those who can communicate with us online. Talk about issues. If you think that something is not going on well in your area, you want some assistance, even if you think that there are some pockets of excellence that you will want us to emulate and share with other areas, the community may raise that. We established the contact through a web address, reach2reach@cog.gov.za. When we started that, we were then focusing mostly on using that contact to talk to us about reporting issues where people feel like there are acts of corruption in the area, to report that. But we then say, in all the five key focus areas of the turnaround strategy, we then say, talk to us. So that is what we do. That's why we took a decision, like I indicated earlier on, that we're also partnering with members of parliament. Because there's no member of parliament that is not assigned to a particular constituency.
Right.
And the constituency is a geographically defined small area where they actually service. To then say, through that, the people should talk to us, because it takes an informed civil society. And through this interaction, the people will be empowered. Knowledge is power. If people know what is going on around, people will be in a position to deal with that.
So is this turnaround strategy working? I mean, it wasn't long ago that I was speaking to the Auditor General, and he didn't have glowing reports about our municipalities across the country. And then you mentioned service delivery, and you know, we switch on the TVs, and it's as recent as last week, you see violent protests, which ostensibly some of them were about wages, but we started to get a hint, actually, there's a lot more going on there, there's a frustration. Is this turnaround strategy working?
We've got to make it work. Mm. If we say it is working, we'll be complacent. But if we then say we've got to get it to work, then we'll always be committed to inject new life into it. That's why, at the moment, what we are doing as a ministry, we are conducting an assessment of the state of municipalities and due to release a report. That which report will then indicate in this area, if there are issues of service delivery, what are the blockages? And then how do we go about addressing that? And come early January, we'll be ready with that, so that we go around. For us is to do more. So the call I make is that let's not be complacent. Let's get the turnaround strategy to work. Let's remove whatever is in its obstacles. Some municipalities will then say, Minister, you see, we believe there are some pieces of legislation that are obstacles to service delivery. You then say to them, which ones are those? Some will then indicate, like for instance, you know, one municipality said, this piece of legislation that prohibit municipalities from evicting people who occupy the land unlawfully. This is unlawful occupation of land, but you can't evict them unless you show them an alternative. They say this one is actually becoming a problem. They have raised that with us. And we are working on to remove this issue, the issue of capacity in some areas. If it is a question of capacity, we have made a call, starting partnership with the academic community through government's program that we introduced in 2008, which we refer to as a revolving door policy, which is a policy encouraging partnership for experience sharing to build capacity between the academic community and municipalities. We are working on that. There are universities that are already, come January, talk to us, we are ready to enlist.
Okay. Minister, to be honest, if I go back 10 years and I'm having this conversation with you, I would have been being told exactly the same thing, that we are addressing, we are dealing, we are going to make a difference. 10 years on, we're still having the same conversation. So how can we convince the people out there that there's something different that's happening now?
That's a very good question. It's not business as usual. 10 years ago, no one in South Africa would have given priority to support municipalities that were found to be failing badly on financial management by the AG last year. 10 years ago, that would not be reality. Come January, we are coming with a program tailor-made to focus on those municipalities that perform according to the audit outcomes that were reported to have performed below. We're just taking those below a point of qualified. And we are taking those ones and accelerate the program. So it can't be correct that 10 years ago you will find a situation like that. Because this is a tailor-made intervention. That's why we are doing the assessment. We are doing the assessment. There are some areas where you find councillors are being removed at will. Now, today you have a council, tomorrow the councillors are not. That contributes to instability on governance. We are not generalizing. We will come with a report come January and then say the number one province in terms of chopping and changing is this one, and we believe it contributes to instability. That is becoming serious about the thing. And we then say this is what we need to do. It can't be said, Peter, that that was the situation even yesterday. So that's why we are seeing.
Can you commit to a timeline now so that we can quote you when we have a conversation sometime in the new year? At what point can we say, Minister Baloyi told us on the 4th of December last year, that by now you will have seen significant gains in your area in terms of service delivery?
We take each municipality on its own merit. That's why, you see, the turnaround strategy says don't throw general statements. First assess the situation. Understand what is the problem. So as we commit, even before the budget debate times next year, in the beginning of the year, we'll indicate that municipality so and so and so has this challenge. We'll tell you that the municipality northwest called Mamusa indicate that what make them not to perform on financial management are the following, and this is what we're doing to address, and then put us to the test in terms of doing that time-bound intervention.
In the meantime, how do you manage the frustrations that are turning into, you know, violence that we haven't seen before? There's an edge more and more now, burning properties, farms, stores. How do we manage that? Because the frustration is boiling over, isn't it?
I think this report we're going to release will actually talk to that. But let me come to that straight. You manage them not in a distance. You can't remote control. You have to be where these things are happening. I was in Swellendam a day before yesterday in the Western Cape. The situation in Swellendam, when you look at the actions that the people are embarking upon, is the same actions you can talk about, say, for instance, in Nelson Mandela Bay or in any other. But you go there, you'll find that the situation, what causes people to reach that stage, is different. So we cannot cut and paste problems. The challenges that get people to take to the street, we have to engage that. That's why we're actually doing that. I'm giving that example because is the latest of the things we're actually embarking upon. Let's do exactly that. There is no one-size-fits-all explanation in terms of what get people to take to the street. Let's get to each one of them and then say this is exactly what happened.
All right, so we're talking about municipalities, we're talking about capacities. How much does party politics play in this? You know, recently we've seen your own party, a vote of no confidence with your own mayors. We're seeing even violence. How much is party politics getting in the way of actually progress, and also the fighting that you have with the opposition parties as opposed to maybe focusing on the needs of the people on the ground?
Yeah, definitely the local environment is affected by anything that happens in that area. If it's positive, then that's a positive contribution. If it's negative, then it's a negative contribution. In this mobilization of actors, which is our responsibility, we engage civil society formations, we engage political mandating structures, we engage, and that talks about political parties. Of course, you'll find situations where things happen in a particular way. Let me again give an example of Selendam. You see, Selendam is a municipality with 9 councillors, 4 from the DA, 4 from the ANC, 1 from the ACDP. We live in a democracy of majority rule. But there, you see, it's a minority rule. When this member, because it's 4-4, when this member decides today I'm voting with the DA, the DA becomes a majority. When they decide to vote with the ANC, that is the situation. Now, you will therefore realize that political organizations, political environment, have an impact on the functioning and of municipalities. Of course, in areas where you find the contribution or the influence is negative, we engage. There are no holocausts here, Peter. We actually engage and then it indicate that now this is exactly, if the contribution is negative, we say, look, your contribution is negative.
Right.
And we want people to talk to us. That's why this number we then say, hey, let them actually talk to us about that.
All right, we'll talk a little bit more, and I think through the questions that come through about local government, municipalities, et cetera. But after the commercial break, I'd like to maybe chat a little bit more about traditional affairs, because that's one aspect that we haven't really interrogated, and we'll get your thoughts on that. So let's take a quick commercial break, and don't forget, you at home, we'd love to hear...